Many of us are distressed about what's going on in Israel, and that's why we are so privileged tonight to have Professor Abraham Sion to give us firsthand information of what is happening in Israel, what it means for now and in the future for the Jewish state. Professor Abraham Sion has served as Deputy State Attorney for Israel and was instrumental in changing the election laws governing the voting in and of the Prime Minister in Israel. Professor Sion was a Lieutenant Colonel in the IDF with 17 years of that service as a judge in Gaza. Professor Sion currently has a weekly program on the popular Reshet Bet channel on Israel radio. He also appears on I-24, which is an English channel out of Israel, and it's fantastic. Professor Sion has headed parliamentary delegations with sitting ministers to Europe and participated in debates concerning the Arab-Israeli conflict. He is frequently a guest on radio and television talk shows, was a member of the executive committee of the Israeli Bar, and has also served as the president of the board of directors of Israel Tourist Industries. He is chairman of the Center for Law and Mass Media at Ariel University and is currently head of a Tel Aviv law firm actively involved in both research and advocacy of law and mass media as it relates to Israel. Professor Sion will take your questions following his talk. Please turn off your cell phones and other electronic devices. And it is now with great pleasure that I bring you Professor Abraham Sion.
Thank you, Doris. Good evening, everybody. I'm very glad to be here. When I left Israel a few days ago, missiles and rockets were still firing. And I don't know whether you can imagine when we say rockets are being fired at Israeli cities and villages and kibbutzes, what does that mean? It's 15 seconds to get to a shelter. And when they fire a rocket, they don't announce it beforehand. So you suddenly listen to the siren, and you've got 15 seconds to get to a shelter. Now, if you're sleeping in your bed in the upper floor, would you be able to get to the basement in 15 seconds? It's almost impossible. And try to imagine living under a situation like that for one day. If you had one day of missiles being shot at you, at your home, where you work, where your children are, how can you manage that? Would you manage it for a month? Would you manage it for a year? Would you manage it for 14 years? 14 years, that's the time that all southern Israel has been living under rockets and missiles. Now, I'm not sure anybody in the world understands that. I think it's also because of Israeli poor hasbara, or public diplomacy, very poor. And still Israel does not, the government of Israel does not feel that hasbara is an important factor, because I was last year visiting the general consulate in New York, and I asked the general consul, how much money does Israel put in hasbara worldwide for a year? And he said, $10 million. $10 million is hardly the PR for a mid-sized company in the United States or in Israel. And I asked another question. I said, how much goes on salary? He said, $6 million. So I said, all Israel puts in hasbara is $4 million for a year around the world? He said, that's the amount. So when we have such a hasbara, then we can see that the Arabs, the Palestinians are on the upper hand because they put into Hasbara billions of dollars a year, billions. And they manage to show Israel in a very poor, in a very dim light in the world. And let me tell you, if you say a lie 1,000 times and you repeat it, it catches up. For example, occupation. Gaza is not under occupation. But when the Gazans say free Palestine or free Gaza, you see people thinking, well, Gaza is under Israeli control. But they have full freedom, and this freedom is dedicated only to one way, and that is to destroy Israel. I don't know what you think about the outcome of this skirmish between, or this fighting between Israel and Gaza. Israel could have annihilated Gaza within 10 days. Annihilated. Wiped out. And it didn't do that. It didn't do that, and Israel was very cautious, even though it bombed Gaza tremendously for a month and a half, it still did not annihilate the Hamas. I can tell you about the Hamas. You know, I was, as Doris said, I was a judge in Gaza, and I used to arrest people who were terrorists. And one day somebody came, the Shin Bet, the Israeli intelligence, brought someone to be arrested. And I asked him, who are you? And he said, I'm Hamas. At that time, that was of course 20 years ago, I didn't know what Hamas was. Nobody knew what Hamas was. It was a new movement coming after the PLO. And you can see that within 20 years, the Hamas became a menace to Israel, like the Hezbollah became a menace to Israel. If you don't destroy a movement like that, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and it becomes more dangerous. Now, the outcome of this war really is no win-win. In other words, Israel did not really win the war, and the Gazans, of course, did not win the war. But the Gazans managed to remain in power for a month and a half under strong bombardments. Now, why did Israel not conquer Gaza and occupy it completely? First of all, I want to think about it philosophically, and then I'll come to the point. Philosophically, the Jews have always had some sort of magnanimity. I can't speak about the strength of Israel. It's a secret. But Israel can wipe out Iran within a few days. Israel has the power, but it's not using it. It's not using it. It's Jewish magnanimity. I mean, I have the power, but I will save your life. I won't destroy you. I won't kill you. That's the philosophical way to think about it. But on the more factual, more practical answer. Any other country, when it's hit by 12,000 missiles within a few years, couldn't just keep quiet. It would have destroyed the enemy, but not Israel. Israel would first of all think, should I destroy him? And if I destroy this Hamas movement, who will come instead of them? Because as I told you, You destroy the Hamas, comes the jihad. You destroy the jihad, comes somebody else, with new names. There's always somebody new. Israel, according to the Arab thinking, should not be there. The Jews have no part in that area. Let them go to where they came from. That's, by the way the Hamas, the charter of the Hamas, the ideology of the Hamas, but not only of the Hamas. Let me give you, for example, I've got here the charter of the Hamas, and maybe you'd like to listen to what they say. And I'm referring to Article 11, the strategy of Hamas. Palestine is an Islamic waqf. The Islamic resistant movement believes that the land of Palestine has been an Islamic waqf throughout the generations. I'll explain what waqf is. Waqf throughout the generations and until the day of resurrection, until the day of eternity. Palestine, a waqf is a sacred land that nobody can give up. That's a waqf. No one can renounce it or part of it or abandon it or part of it. No Arab country, nor the aggregate of all Arab countries can do that. And then following this, they say, there is no solution to the Palestinian problem except jihad. Jihad is sacrifice. Jihad means getting killed by killing other people, killing mostly Jews, of course. The initiatives, proposals, and international conferences are but a waste of time, an exercise in futility. So it's a war, an unending war. It's a war that will never end. In other words, fight the Jews until resurrection. This is a place for the Muslims alone. Now, I come back to the Jewish thinking, Israeli thinking, Jewish thinking. If we destroy the Hamas, somebody else will come over, and maybe it will be worse. That's what happened in the past in Lebanon. We destroyed we threw out the Palestinians from Lebanon, and then came the Hezbollah, which was much worse than the Palestinians. So first of all, we think, is it going to do any good for Israel? This is one thing. The second thing is the number of casualties. I can say, also as being member of the Israeli army, that in Israel, the army has a country. Not the country has an army. In other words, the country should defend the army rather than the army should defend the country. So when missiles fall for many years over cities in Israel, we can absorb it. But if they kidnap one soldier or kill a soldier, that's something that we cannot afford to allow. So the question is, how many casualties will we have if we were to go into Gaza and go to all these tunnels that are, there's a city under a city at the moment. And we should go in. And this would cost Israel by something like between 500 and 750 casualties in soldiers. Now, I have students who are soldiers. One of my students was killed in this war. It's a terrible thing. He left a wife and a pregnant wife and a child of 1 year old. It's a terrible thing. Every soldier, and nobody of us wants to be in the same position as Netanyahu, who has to make those decisions. But it's a very difficult decision. So what the Israeli cabinet is thinking, we would deter the Palestinians in such a way that even if they had weapons, they would not dare fire those weapons against us again. It worked with the Hezbollah. You know, with the Hezbollah, after the Second Lebanese War, there was a truce, and nobody in Israel liked this truce. Nobody. Everybody was very skeptic about it. And yet, we had the best 8 years since. Not even one rocket was fired. There was a rocket fired, but it did not make any casualties or anything. So we are thinking, or the cabinet is thinking, and I'm trying to put myself in the cabinet position, they're thinking that if we deter the Palestinians, then maybe we'll have peace for the next 8-10 years to come. But there's no guarantee for that. It's very likely that the Hamas would not keep quiet for 10 years. It's going to rearm itself and build maybe more tunnels or find other ways of fighting. And they are actually working very hard trying to find ways to attack Israel. In this position, I'm sad to say that the Arabs are taking the initiative. The Israelis are not taking the initiative. Israelis are only answering the initiatives of the Arabs, whether it's in the battlefield or whether it's in public diplomacy. You can see that the Arabs are working hard every day to see how they can cause damage to Israel. And Israel is only responding. It's never initiating anything. You will never hear an Israeli say that the Arabs have no rights in their countries, and we will not make a big thing out of it, or that there is apartheid in Arab countries. Nobody really asked why in Egypt, in Jordan, in Iraq, in Lebanon, there isn't any Jew in any position, whether it's in the parliament, whether it's as a judges. The Jews are, there's in such an apartheid, the Jews cannot get anywhere, even if in places that they aren't Jews. For example, in Damascus, you won't find any Jew who can get anywhere there. But we have a Supreme Court judge. We have 10 members of Knesset who are working for the Arabs, working for the Palestinians, working for the terrorists. They represent the terrorists in Israeli parliament. So they call us a country of apartheid, and we don't say that they have the apartheid. Look how they treat their women. Equality, there's no equality. There is no judgment, no courts. I served in Gaza, and I can tell you that when I served in Gaza, Gaza was very peaceful. I mean, I could walk in uniform in the streets and nobody would even come near me. I would go into a restaurant and eat and nobody would poison me. And I don't have even to take a weapon. You can see what happened since. You know, those who fought today in this war are the children of the Oslo Agreement. The Oslo Agreement was in 1993, and they were born at that time. And now they are paying the price of this agreement. This agreement is the worst thing that happened to the Jewish people since the birth of Israel. It was a big mistake. I'll come to it soon. So this is the reason, the practical reason, why Israel did not destroy the Hamas in Gaza, and why Israel believes, the Israeli government, I mean. The people are very skeptical still, and those living around Gaza did not return to their homes. I don't know whether you read about the child, the four-year-old child who was killed. I mean, his father was near him, he just looked back and the child was killed. just in a minute, in a second. So people are quite skeptical. They are afraid, obviously. When you have children, you are afraid. You care about them. But the cabinet thinks that this is going to last after when the Palestinians will see the destruction, the amount of destruction that happened, they would certainly think twice next time. But also, there is another thing to this situation, and this is the fact that the number of casualties was very low. Of course, the whole world, whether it's in the United States or in Europe and other places, they say, how come there's no balance? You had 70 people killed, and they had 2,000. The 2,000, by the way, is a number that was given by the Hamas. I don't believe them. I don't believe them. I think there were many more than 2,000. Because, you see, whenever they spoke about casualties in their side, it was always women and children. Always. There's a child and a woman, and a child and a woman were killed. You will never hear that there was a Palestinian terrorist, a fighter that was killed. But now, our soldiers counted at least 1,000. And the 1,000 is a very small number, because many, when the tunnels were destroyed, many were destroyed with the tunnels. Because there were soldiers, there were terrorists in the tunnels, hiding. So there were many more than 2,000. But the 2,000 serves our purpose. I mean, it was not a big number. But actually, the number of casualties that we had is relatively very small, and this is also a great achievement because of the Iron Dome. If it wasn't for the Iron Dome, I can tell you things would have been different, and many people more were killed, and maybe Israel would have been forced to go into Gaza, and maybe with more casualties on both sides. Now the Hamas is in public eye. But let me tell you, the Hamas is not that dangerous like the Palestinian Authority, like Abu Mazen. You know, Abu Mazen speaks the language that the Americans and the Europeans and the Westerns understand. He says, I'm against terrorism, I'm against killing. Of course, he did nothing to prove that, but he says that. He's against it. But what he does is much worse. He is trying on the international arena to discredit Israel and to bring to its destruction. How? He's trying now to get a statehood on the United Nations. And he would manage that. And this is against the Oslo Accords. The Oslo Accords say that nobody, no side, can do anything to change the situation in the Middle East, in that area, one-sidedly, without the consent of the other party. So now they are trying, with the Oslo Accord and with the fact that the Americans and the Russians were signatories on the Oslo Accords, now he's trying to get statehood in Judea and Samaria. Now, Israel really has been very poor in explaining Judea and Samaria. It's the West Bank. You know, the Jordan River, I'm sure many of you have been there, is so narrow. How can the Jordan River have a bank that has cities and villages and whole areas? But the Arabs called it the bank of the Jordan River in order not to call it Judea and Samaria. Actually, the Arabs are doing everything they can to change history, to rewrite history, as if the Judea and Samaria was never Jewish and Jerusalem was really did not belong to the Jews. They even say that they are descendants of the Philistines who came before Moses and the Jewish people who came at that time. B'nai Israel. And it works. They say it again and again and again. You know, I was, last time I was here, it was 6 months ago. And I was in a program in San Diego. And my counterpart came over and said, I am the son of a general, an Israeli general. And he was the son of an Israeli general. But he said, who said that the Jews of today are the descendants of King David? They are saying that Jerusalem belongs to them and that Jerusalem is the city of David. But they are not the descendants of King David. He's a Jew, and he's the son of Mati Peled, a general in the Israeli army, and he comes on television in the United States discrediting the Jewish people and saying, who said that the Jews of today are the descendants of King David? Outrageous. Now, why would a man like that do that? What did the Jewish people do to him or to his father to deserve such a thing to go around? And not only, I was with him in San Diego, but he goes around the world spreading this nonsense. And then I have to explain that the Jewish people of today are the descendants of David. He comes with something absurd, and then we have to explain. And this is what happens all the time with the Arab propaganda. They come over and say that they are the descendants of Philistines. Let me tell you one thing. I was asked a question, a very simple question. Tell me, how long Israel has been, when was Israel born? When was Israel established? And I answered a very simple answer, 65 years ago. And he said, when was Palestine established? I said, there was never a Palestine. He said, yes, in the maps, I have maps of 200 years ago, they call this area Palestine. So who came before? Who came after? You, the Israelis, you came after the Palestinians. You took the land from the Palestinians, because I have maps who say that. Because of magnanimity and because of we were trying to be so kind to the Arabs. You know, some people in Israel say the Arabs also deserve a country, a state. On top of the 22 that they have, they also deserve a state. You know, many Israelis say that. Left-wing Israelis, liberals, also I believe in the United States, say that they also deserve a country. But it was only Israel who offered them a country. Because the Palestinians were 19 years under Jordanian rule and the Jordanians never offered them a country. And the same with Gaza. The Egyptians, who never claimed sovereignty over Gaza, never offered them a country. It was only Israel who came to Arafat in the worst time of his life, soon after the Gulf War, when all, even the Arabs, did not want to have anything to do with the Palestinians. And they said, we want to make peace with you. We want to have, to give you, at that time they did not speak about a state, but they said, we want to give you self-rule. And maybe a state in the end. Instead of saying thank you, soon after Arafat landed here, buses started being blown and people started being murdered in cinemas and cafes and in the streets and everywhere. I mean, if Israel did not offer Arafat statehood, he would have died as an arch-terrorist in Tunis, 3,000 kilometers away. And maybe he would have gone down the drain in the history of the old times. But the Israelis came to him and said, we want peace, but we'll not get peace Instead of peace, we got terror. The only difference is that this terror was in our own cities. Because imagine what happened. We brought in people, gave them weapons and ammunition without any borders. So they could use those ammunition against those weapons against Israelis, not in Ariel, but in Tel Aviv. So the fighting was not because of the Judea and Samaria. The fighting was everywhere. In other words, the Arabs say, not only the Hamas, by the way, I've got the charter of the Hamas, but I can tell you that the charter of the PLO is exactly the same, that Palestine, from the Jordan River to the Mediterranean, belongs to the Muslims, and the Jews have nothing to do there. So it's not a war on territory. It's a religious war. And religious wars are the worst. We still remember the Black Ages, the Dark Ages of the Middle Ages, when Jews were burnt because of religious war. And this is the situation that is happening now. And if we don't wake up, and if we continue to give on to the Arabs, to waive our rights on various places, on various things, then we're going to lose more and more. I think now the Israeli public and also the Jewish community, of course I'm not speaking about J Street, but I'm speaking about the Jewish community, I can call it the Zionist Jewish community, or the Jewish community who cares about Israel, are beginning to understand that all the what we gave to the Arabs, what we offered the Arabs, did not bring peace. On the contrary. Actually, by offering the Palestinians a state, we discredited Israel, and we made a delegitimization of the state of Israel. And at the moment, you know, the Palestinians, the Palestine and Israel is on the same level. Now you take a nation that has been here for 4,000 years, maybe the oldest nation that survived. And you have another nation, which has been established not more than 60 years ago. And they claim the old city of Jerusalem, and we have to fight for that. Who's to blame? The Jewish people have to blame. The Israeli government has to blame. Because when we say everything is on the table, also Jerusalem is on the table, they say we want Jerusalem, and Jerusalem is ours. Now I can tell you that because of humanitarian grounds, magnanimity, we have made many mistakes. All these mistakes are against our interests because we wanted to be nice to the other side. We thought that this is going to bring peace. We thought that we are going to be part of the world, the world is going to accept us. I can tell you just a few of them, or the big mistakes. You know that after the Six-Day War, Israel controlled Judea and Samaria and Gaza, and it could have done anything in its will. Moshe Dayan came to the Arabs and said, I want to give you religious sovereignty over Mount Temple Mount. And we lost Temple Mount because of that. Because the Arabs eradicated every Jewish thing in Temple Mount. They left nothing. Lorries were taking all this rubble out from beneath, and they made the place where King Solomon had his horses. And there was a big temple, Jewish temple there. They took it all out in front of our eyes, and we could do nothing. We could do something, but we didn't do anything. When after the Six-Day War, soon after the Six-Day War, many Arabs fled from Judea and Samaria to Jordan. You know who stopped them? Moshe Dayan. He sent the Israeli army to say, come back to your homes, we are not going to do anything bad to you. Return to your homes. And after that, we had many people come back to their sort of reunion of families. So out of the 200,000 that left, maybe only 100,000 remained in Jordan and 100,000 came back. And this 100,000 became now 400,000. And then you have the Oslo Accords, which, as I said, was the worst thing that happened to us since the birth of Israel. And then you have the wars take for example the last war with Hamas. I think it was a big mistake to stop the war or to make a truce at this stage. Israel should have gone in spite of what I said before, of the casualties, and taken hold of Gaza. I think if we would have taken hold of Gaza, we would have needed 25 years, a whole generation, to bring them back to what they were before. In other words, today, they have been brainwashed to be jihadist, to kill Jews. This is the highest thing that they can achieve. It's the greatest thing. Is that don't get a Nobel Prize, don't be a doctor, don't be a lawyer, be a jihadist. And if you are a jihad, then you have an esteem. And let me tell you that all memorials that have been made in Ramallah, in other Palestinian places, were for those who blow themselves up and kill as many Jews as possible. One more problem that we have is Jewish anti-Semitism. Jewish self-hatred, people who hate their own origin, and we have many of these. And let me tell you that the boycott started by Jews, not by Gentiles. It started by Jews and it caught up like fire. And now we are in a situation, a terrible situation, of boycott. And many of those who are trying to incite to boycott are Jewish people. I can tell you something that I witnessed last year. I have a colleague in the university who applied to participate in a conference in Heidelberg, in Germany. And he was accepted. Only 2 weeks later, just a week before the conference, he was told that he cannot come because he lives in an occupied area. He lives in an area which was taken from the Arabs. It's an occupied area. And he was very furious and outraged, and he approached me and some of my colleagues, and we decided to write letters, every one of us, to the Heidelberg conference leaders to complain about this. What I wrote was that I'm amazed that the German university in a German land, in a German country, is preaching to Israel about occupation. And in the end, it worked out that they got those letters and they said, all right, you can come. But you can see how it's working. I mean, it's in academic life, I can tell you, for example, I have some colleagues in England who wrote to me about a boycott of English supermarkets who are selling goods from the West Bank. That says, like Ariel. So, like Sainsbury, like Soda Stream, or something like that. So, then they said that they should stop this, and when they did not stop selling those goods, then they started doing all sorts of riots and shouting and with flags and in front of the shop. And in the end, the shop yielded. It decided to stop bringing in Israeli goods to their markets. And this is carrying on. And in the end, they want to bring us to become South Africa, while we have no apartheid, and we have more rights for citizens than more than any, not only the Arab countries, but many Western countries. And the situation is that those boycotts that have been started by Jews are carrying on and taking more, becoming more fierce. I want to tell you something about the Center for Law and Mass Media that I head, that I am the chair. I taught in Tel Aviv University for many years. And when Ariel was established, it was like a very small college in Ariel, somewhere in the West Bank. It's like beyond the seas. And I decided to leave Tel Aviv University, which is very near my home, and it's a high-ranking university, and to go to Ariel, which is a small college. And I can tell you that the college is 30 years old, but it has now 15,000 students. And it's one of the, I wouldn't say the best, but one of the good universities of Israel. And the Center for Law and Mass Media actually deals with this particular problem, the Arab-Israeli conflict. People don't know very much about it. People, for example, don't know that Palestine, on two sides of the border, was promised to the Jewish people and to the Jewish people alone. It started with the Balfour Declaration, it went on to the San Remo Declaration, and then to the British Mandate. What was the British Mandate? The British Mandate was that the United Nations, or at that time the League of Nations, gave the British government a mandate over Palestine to establish a Jewish national home in Palestine. Now, what would happen to the Arabs? I can only tell you that at that time, Jews were a minority, a small minority. What about self-determination? Why would anybody give to a minority statehood in a place that has many other people? When the First World War ended, Britain and France, the victorious states, decided to split the Middle East, that was the remnants of the Ottoman Empire, to split it between the French and the English. The British got Mesopotamia, which is Iraq, and Palestine, and the French got Syria and Lebanon. The French and the British decided to give the Arabs three states, Mesopotamia, Syria, and Lebanon. To the Jewish people, only one state. So what they said at that time, and it's all written, it's part of international law, I'm not saying anything new. What was said in the British Mandate is that the Arabs, which were the majority, would get religious and civil rights, and that alone, not national rights. National rights will be given only to the Jewish people. What can be more definite than that? But then, soon after that, in 1922, the British government tore 78% of the area and turned it into Transjordan. It's against the British mandate, but it did it. It did it with the acceptance of the semi-acceptance of the League of Nations. But then what was remained was the western part of Palestine. This was dedicated to the Jewish people and to them alone. Now, did you hear any Israeli leader say that in so many words? No. When Israel fights for the west part of Palestine, it speaks only about security. It doesn't speak about the rights of the Jewish people in that land. And this is one of the big mistakes that's been done. So the Center for Law and Mass Media is there to make research and to go very much deep into this and to try to spread this as much as possible, first of all to the Israeli people, to the Israeli government, but also to the United States and in Europe. And I can tell you, we had 5 conferences, 1 conference a year, an international conference, a conference that was very much worked upon. And we invited cabinet ministers to these conferences. And I think, with all modesty, that we have contributed something to the fact that the way of thinking has changed. You must have noticed that Netanyahu now, not like Netanyahu 10 years ago, Netanyahu now speaks about the rights of the Jewish people in Israel, in the land of Israel, in Judea and Samaria. And you hear also some other cabinet ministers and politicians and also others from the academia that speak about the rights of the Jewish people in that part of the world. So I would like, first of all, to thank you for listening, and I'm open to questions.
Okay, I have the microphone because we need to hear, but I'm going to start back here because I always start in the front. And please limit your question to a question.
My question is,
do you think it's occupied?
No, he does. I don't. I'm asking a question. I'm Wilbur Phillips, and my question is, what is the true relationship now between the President Obama and Netanyahu?
Well, you see, when you have relationship between states, the relationships are between states. But it is important that the leaders of those states, there will be some chemistry between them. There is no chemistry between Netanyahu and Obama. None whatsoever. But, the United States and Israel think alike. They have the same way of, they have the same aims, and they want to achieve the same things. So you can see that with all the fact that Obama and Netanyahu, there is no chemistry, there's nothing between them, that the American administration has given Israel $220 million for the Iron Dome, that the Obama administration is willing to veto any decision against Israel in the Security Council. So you see that the interests are still there, but between the two leaders, I wouldn't like to say that they hate each other, but they certainly dislike each other.
Why do you say that God? Gaza's not occupied?
Sorry?
Why did you say that Gaza's not occupied?
Why did I say Gaza?
It's not occupied.
Oh, it's not.
Did they have freedom of passage? Out of the country, into their country?
Why should they have freedom of passage?
Oh, of course.
Why should they have? Let me tell you. Occupation means that a country rules another country. Israel does not rule the Gaza Strip. Israel forces are not in Gaza Strip. Israel does not tell the Gazans what to do. The Gazans are free to do whatever they like. They have a government, they have soldiers, they have an army, and they are attacking Israel all the time. Now, does France have to allow passage for the Germans? Does Poland have to allow a passage for another country? Why should Israel allow passage, freedom of passage? Israel has a border with Gaza, and you cannot cross the border in any state without having permission of that country. Why should Israel allow freedom of passage? Especially when the freedom of passage is only for terrorist act.
What about the seaports?
What about them? What about them?
I'm keeping control here. Okay, I have the microphone, it's my event. So let's just take it one at a time. Thank you.
Yeah. I know this question asks IDF security issues and international political issues. However, is there any sort of strategy by Israel to enable or allow the Jewish people to expand all the way to the Jordan River? In other words, open up settlements and establish a continuous economy, infrastructure, and everything else, so we have our homeland.
First of all, the Israeli settlements, called settlements, but they are cities actually, cities and towns, are flourishing like Israel. I mean, I invite you to come to Ariel. It's a wonderful city. And the Israeli law applies there. You know, one of the funny things is that Israel, the Jewish thinking, is if you are in Ariel, which is in Samaria, and you want to sell a house, you sell it by the Israeli law. The Israeli law applies. But if you want to build a house, then you build it by the Jordanian law. And if you want to sell a house to a non-Jewish person, then the international law applies. Now, since the Oslo Accords, new settlements were not built in Judea and Samaria. Unfortunately, well, actually, what did the Oslo Accords really mean? They meant that to establish a Palestinian state in Judea and Samaria and Gaza. So then, new settlements stopped. But people were, more houses were built in the settlements that already were there. New people were born, and new people were married, and children were born, so you had to expand and to build new homes and so forth. It only started with Obama, who said, no more settlements, no more building, no more building. You know, there was a time when Israel could not build a balcony in a house in Judea and Samaria without the permission of the American consul or ambassador in Tel Aviv, who asked Obama or the administration whether to allow a balcony to be built in the house. That was for 9 months. But on the whole, I can tell you that the University of Ariel, for example, has expanded tremendously in the last 5 years, in spite of everything. So I would have liked more houses to be built, more settlements to be established. After all, you know, the Bible does not speak about Tel Aviv or Netanya. It speaks about Hebron and about Jerusalem and about Nablus or Shechem. Those are the places where the ancestors came from. This is the Jewish tradition. It's there, and it's all written in the Bible. And we want to bring it back. The Hebrew language, you know, it's fantastic. When I was in Turkey, and I noticed one very important thing. You know that after the First World War, the language, the Turkish language changed from Arabic letters to Latin letters. And I was thinking when I was there that the pupils, the students in schools cannot understand what's written in the archaeology of Turkey. But our students in Israel can understand what was written 4,000 years ago. It's the same language and it's the same letters. Fantastic. So we want to revive the language, we want to revive the country, and we want to revive our tradition in Judea and Samaria.
Right here.
My name is Helene. In contrast to the Egypt and the UN putting pressure on Israel to ceasefire with Hamas, how come they don't put pressure to stop the Syrian war, and to stop the insurgents in Iraq?
A very good question, and I have a very good answer. It's the double standard. You know, one thing that struck me.
They've had that war for 4 years, and nobody broke.
Right. It's you know, if the Palestinians were living in Uganda or in Central Africa, and not 2,000 of them were being killed, 200,000 of them would have been killed, you wouldn't find one section in the newspaper. The only reason that you're reading about the Palestinians every day is because the Jews are involved in this war. That's the only reason. So when you have people being killed in Syria, nobody cares. If you have people being massacred in Iraq, nobody cares. But when it comes to the Jews, that's a different matter.
Hi, Professor. I wanted to have you address the question that was raised by that gentleman across the aisle, which may or may not have been a hostile question, but it is a question that...
No, it's okay.
Yes,
I can manage.
Yes, I know you can. And so I think it's appropriate that you address the question. And he asked about this issue of occupation of Gaza. And you responded with respect to the Israeli border. He asked about, well, what about the maritime access? Or he might have asked as well about the airspace over Gaza. And if I could suggest something, you might mention that when Israel ceded Gaza in 2005, that a lot of the restrictions that were imposed after the coup by Hamas were not in effect. In any event, please, if you could respond to his question.
Well, after Israel withdrew from Gaza, Gaza had a port, it also had an airport, and they lived their lives. It all began when terrorism started. And when terrorism started, there is no other way but to stop it, to stop this bringing in weapons through the sea by closing the port. And this—the only reason for that is the fact of terrorism. It's the same thing with the wall. They call it it's actually a fence, but it's called the wall. Between Judea and Samaria and the Green Line, The reason for this wall was terrorism. And you can see that terrorism stopped. I mean, I can travel to Ariel and back in midnight. It's as safe as driving in Tel Aviv. And the only reason was because there was a wall and that the Israeli IDF got into the cities of, I wouldn't say reoccupying the West Bank, but going into those places where it monitored every terrorist activity beforehand. So there is peace and quiet. Yeah.
When you commented on Turkey, there's no country that occupies another country more than Turkey. It occupies 40% of Cyprus. And Turkey itself was occupied by the Greeks, so there is truly an occupied country. But I have a different question. The conflict with the Arabs seems endemic. It's not something that's going to be solved today, 10 years, maybe 100 years from now. But that type of a conflict, where you're under this constant pressure, what does it do to Israeli cohesion? I get a feeling that there may be a benefit from it in this regard. You mentioned about the Israeli army has a country. That's what was said of Prussia, that Prussia was an army of a country. To what degree does what the Arabs are doing impose upon Israel a social cohesion that it would never have and be very fractious, which is
the normal Jewish state. Well, let me tell you, the conflict is putting Israelis together. You know, if you have two Israelis in one room, or two Jewish people in one room, there are four opinions. So it's putting them together, and we could see this in this war. There was a unity, and the people were united. But I would rather have peace with disunity rather than have unity with war. So let's hope that peace will come someday, and it will come. It will come. You know, in history between countries, there was always wars, and then peace came when the people came to a conclusion, when both sides came to a conclusion, that war is not going to bring any good, any benefit. And I'm sorry to say that in our attitude towards the Arabs, by not showing power or enough power, they always have the feeling that they can win in the end. So they try again and try again and try again. If you would have used only 10% of the power of Israel against them, maybe things would have been different.
I want to ask you here, it's in continuation with this question. Do you know who Gadi Taub is?
Do?
Gadi Taub. Okay, never mind. Anyway, he was just talking from the liberal side, although he's disappointed with Oslo, etc. But the end of his conversation was, the real problem of Israel is the settlement, and the real problem of Israel is the Haredis.
And the what? Was,
the Haredis.
What about them?
That they were the real problem of Israel.
Oh, the real problem.
Let me finish. And the idea was that Zionism is a secular, it's coming up, Zionism is a secular endeavor and preoccupied with democracy in Israel. And the fact that we want the land and that we care about the religious part is out of the question. So this is the real division among the Jews, and this is why we've not been able to give a unified. What can you do about that in terms of working with the liberal side of Israel? Because that's an issue that's constantly recurring.
Well, first of all, I would ask a question. In a Jew always answers by a question. So I'll ask a question. If Israel would have stopped fighting, would there have been peace? Never. If the Arabs would have stopped fighting, there would have been peace. So you can say that the initiators of all these fighting are the Arabs. Now, they come over and they repeat what the Arab narrative is. It's the settlements. What about them? What's wrong with the settlements? We had settlements in Gaza and we left Gaza. We had settlements in Sinai and we left Sinai. Israel is very good at destroying settlements that it built. So if it comes to real peace, who knows, we might destroy all the settlements. So the settlements is no object. I would answer you in a different manner. There were no settlements in Judea and Samaria before 1967. And the PLO was established in 1964. Why? To annihilate the state of Israel within the Green Line. So it has nothing to do with settlements. As I say, it's a war of religion, it's not a war of territory. I think that the liberal attitude, or the left attitude, comes maybe from for three reasons. One reason is that they are naive. Yes. You know, Yitzhak Rabin was a great leader, but he was naive. And he believed that he was drawn by the nose by Shimon Peres. But he believed that what do the Arabs want? Why are they fighting us all this time? They want a state. All right, we'll give them a state. He did not know at that time that they were not fighting for a state. They could have got a state a long time ago. Barak, our Barak, Ehud Barak, the Prime Minister of Israel, offered them a state with Jerusalem, and they said no. You know why they said no? Does anybody know why they said no? Barak offered them the 1967 ceasefire lines with Jerusalem, and he says no. He said, I want my people to go to your land. Now, who would want to have a state and have his people go to another people's land? Then suddenly Barak understood that he doesn't want a state. He wants the destruction of Israel. And the destruction of Israel can be only by the, as Arafat said, by the Arab mother's womb. That's what he said. In other words, by demography. So, as I say, it's naivety, and also it's a mistaken belief that if you give and give and give, they will make peace. But this proved to be wrong.
Professor, in the context, it seems to me that Israel has not been very creative at all in trying to find a realistic solution for this, which does exist.
For what?
A realistic solution for its problem with its Arab neighbors, in particular, especially the Palestinians.
Two-state solution, did you say?
No, I did not. Israel is not being creative and looking, searching for a solution to its problem with the Palestinians, those who are Arabs within west of the Jordan River. And as you are aware, under international law, under Article 25 of the Mandate for Palestine, that the West Bank, or the East Bank, excuse me, of the Jordan River is designated, as an Arab, was designated for an Arab state as of 1922. And it seems to me that if Israel has any influence with the United States, although that's diminishing, but if it was to use it creatively, that it should, instead of, building power plants and factories in the Arab areas,
to build those areas in the in Jordan, which is already Palestinian anyway, to make that a very attractive economic enterprise for them, and they would eventually, you know, leave this area and take there.
Let me try to understand. You say that Israel should have built factories in Jordan?
The United States should do that. Make the, instead of American money going and supporting the Palestinians, I mean the Arabs west of the Jordan, which they're doing in Gaza, it should be done with wherever in the east side.
I agree with you. Because funding that is coming from Western countries is going to the wrong purpose. It's going only for terrorism. It's not going for any building. You know that very little has been built by the Arabs since the Oslo Accord. And they could have built. They could have built a lot of factories. Israel gave them every power that they needed for that. And also I can tell you that Shimon Peres, after the Oslo Agreement, went over to Germany and to other places in Europe and said, if you have money to give us, don't give it to us, give it to them, give it to the Palestinians, they need it more than we do. So we tried everything we could, but you can see that all the money that came from Qatar to the Gaza Strip went to build tunnels. It didn't build anything really for the good of the people.
So what is your vision, Dr. Zion? For all the questions,
Dr.
Zion.
He's got the
microphone here.
Yeah.
Dr. Zion, first of all, thank you for a lifetime of service to Israel.
Thank you.
We all get us so excited, but I know that I live in the United States and California, 10 time zones away. My wife and I have been honored to make 6 trips to Israel for 2 weeks. Could you give us some visit and insight as to what is going on in that inner circle with Naftali Bennett, with Zvi Lipni, and it's all not peaches and roses in that inner circle. And so what is going on amongst those 5 or 6 people? Mr. Lieberman, another one. Give us some insight. Thank you.
Well, I would say, Netanyahu started studying architecture in the MIT. And he is an architect to construct the government with the extreme right and the extreme left in the same government, and they sit in the cabinet and they have to make decisions. Now, Tzipi Livni is the extreme left, and Naftali Bennett is the extreme right, and in the middle you have other people like Steinitz and Lapid, who have different ideas. To put those people together is an impossible thing to do. And Netanyahu managed to do that, and it seems to be working. I would have liked to see better decisions, but everybody can make decisions with himself. When it comes to making decisions with other people, it becomes more difficult. So, when you see the way it's working, the cabinet, in with extreme right and extreme left, you say, well, Netanyahu is doing a good job.
No, I think it's my turn. I've been in a pressure course in history from you. I served in Gaza as a soldier. I served in Gaza.
When?
For many years, you know.
Yeah, when?
I was in Israel.
Maybe we met there.
Probably 67, 68, 69.
No, I wasn't in 69. Right. Okay.
You know, I'm still wondering when the peace treaty was signed with Egypt, why Israel didn't force to give back Gaza to Egypt.
Because Egypt did not want Gaza.
That's right. But my question
is why they didn't enforce it. Because, you know, Gaza was always a trouble area, trouble area for Israel, you know, for Israel even before 67. We know that. Why did they insist on that? Why they left this problem in our hands?
Look, you can insist. But a decision, but when you make a treaty, you make a treaty with the other side. The other side knew exactly what the Gazans are. So he did not want Gaza, he did not want the people there. And at that time, don't forget, there were only, when you're talking about 67, 69, there were only 150,000 people there, not a million and a half, only 150,000. And he didn't want them. Now, he wanted to get back to the international borderline between Sinai and Israel. And that was what he said, that's what I'm prepared to do. Now, Begin had to decide, is he going to give up this agreement, or is he going to take it as it is? Because at the beginning, we were thinking of having a line from El Arish to Sharm el-Sheikh. You know, but Egypt did not accept that. So we had to decide, are we going to take it or leave it? And we took it. And we are paying for it. Yeah, we are certainly paying for it. Yeah.
You mentioned correctly that all the conflicts have a resolution. So what is your vision of resolution given the current events and status of affairs? How would you like to see the resolution between Israel and Palestinians?
There is no solution.
Thank you.
I want to add another sentence.
I have a question.
There is no solution today. But that doesn't mean that there will be no solution tomorrow. Tomorrow, that can be 20 years from now, 100 years from now, or 200 years from now.
So you prefer status quo?
Well, the status quo as it is better then, there's no other way.
I'm just asking, yes
yeah,
or no?
Yeah, yeah, the status quo is this.
I have a question. You talk about the agreements that have been signed between nations, the Balfour Agreement, and the United Nations, and so on. Is there any group in Israel that is actively studying the Quran and the Hadith and the Bible, and showing how this conflict, which is a spiritual war, is a spiritual conflict, how in fact it cannot be resolved without the Islamics admitting that Muhammad is a false prophet and Allah is a counterfeit God. They will never accept the presence of a single Jew on earth, let alone in Israel, because Muhammad said that once the Holy Land is taken for Islam, it will never be lost. So that's why they have no Israel on their maps. That's why they are motivated to destroy Israel, because if Israel exists, it tells them that Muhammad is a false prophet and their religion is bogus.
Now, I want to answer that. Is there, Doris, is there a time limit or?
No, we're here all
night. Okay. I want to answer that. We have a professor, a colleague of mine in Ariel University. He went to the Quran. You'll be amazed what he found. He found that in the Quran, they say that the land of Israel belongs to the Jews. You know that? Now, I found in the Quran, I once was in a conference in Spain, and the Imam of Jericho said that you have no rights, according to the history, you have no rights in Palestine. And I said, I saw in the Quran a sentence saying that the Jews will come from all corners of the land to their land. He said, impossible. So I said, open that chapter. And he opened the chapter, And it was written that the Jews will come back to the land. He says, where does it say Palestine? I say, when the Jews say the land, it means Israel. The land. Well, you know, when I say I'm going to Israel, I say, Ani olech la'aretz. I never say I'm going to Israel. I say, I went to the land. That's the way it's done. And you know, the Quran is a copy, a bad copy of the Bible. You know, all the stories of the Bible, like the story of Joseph, is written in the Quran. And all our people of the Jews, like Moses and like Joseph, they are in the Quran prophets. You know, there are many Arabs who are called Musa. Musa is Moses. Many Arabs called Yusuf. Yusuf is Joseph. So they are called by Jewish names. And the same way as the Quran copied those stories from the Bible, like the story of Joseph is written there, but written with all sorts of mistakes. You know, it reminds me of someone who heard the story from somebody else as hearsay and wrote it down, because Muhammad did not know how to write. So somebody was telling him how to write, and he wrote it later. So you see all these stories with slight distortions, but they're all there. So when it says the Jews will come from all parts of the country to the land, it was taken from the Bible, because it says in Isaiah that this is what's going to happen. So it's written there. Why should I say it's false and it's bogus? I would say, look into the Quran and see the answers. It's all there.
Thank you, Professor. I've been to Ariel 13 years ago, and I was very impressed.
You wouldn't recognize Ariel today, I can tell you.
There was a Russian women choir, and kids were doing all kinds of beautiful computer work. I was very impressed. I went with Israel Moms. Now, my question to you is, how do you feel about Egypt? Egypt in this conflict seemed like to push the United States away. Harry was very weak and almost non-existent. And Egypt took the lead. And you think it's a positive thing for CC? What do you think your opinion?
First of all, don't trust anybody. I can only tell you this, that the Egyptian regime today is much more, working much better with Israel than ever before. Because it realized that the Hamas, who is actually the Muslim Brothers, is against the interests of Egypt. So at the moment, we couldn't have it better. Now, it's terrible to say that the American administration, with all the intelligence that it has, and with all the information, maybe number one in the world, it's interpreting the situation in the most strongly manner. Totally wrong. It cannot see, for example, how did the Hamas come into power? Because of the Americans. Israel said, we're not going to make elections, and the Americans said, no, you must make elections, you must allow elections. The elections came, the Hamas won, and then got power, and since then there are no elections. It's the same with Egypt. And the American administration did not back Sisi, who is now the president of Egypt, which was a mistake. It backed the Muslim Brothers, which is totally wrong from the point of view of the West. So at the moment, let it continue this way.
I would like to ask you about the Israeli Arabs. And how many, how do they live? Do they live in separate quarters? We don't hear very much about them.
The Israeli Arabs have all the rights that no other Arab in any other Arab country has. In other words, they live in total democracy. They are equal in the courts. They are equal everywhere. We have judges who are Arabs. We have members of Knesset who are Arabs, who are actually not working for the Arab interests. And we have, they're not working for the Arab interests. They're working for the Palestinian Authority, not for the Arab interests. They have they hardly deal with the problems, daily problems of the Arabs in Israel. But on the other hand, in the last 10 years, the Arabs of Israel became more extreme. They are, they now, many of them call themselves Palestinians with an Israeli citizenship. In other words, they regard themselves as Palestinians more than Israelis. This is something that started maybe 10, 15 years ago after the Oslo Accords. They began to side with their brothers and Palestinian brothers against the interests of Israel. And also, the leadership, the Arab leadership, is trying to cause the youngsters not to join the Israeli army, for example. And also, they are working 24 hours a day to have autonomy within Israel. In other words, to turn Israel to a do-national state, in doing it in a very subtle way. In other words, you know, in Israel, you can do anything. There's freedom of thinking, freedom of speech. You can say whatever you like, but you cannot use violence. So they're not using violence. All they say is, we don't want a Jewish state. What's wrong with that? We want a state which is of all its citizens. Why do we have the law of return for the Jews alone? We want also a law of return for the Palestinians. Why should we have Keren Kayemet only for the Jewish people? We want Keren Kayemet for the Arabs, the Keren Kayemet to serve the Arabs. And actually, they managed to make some victories. They went to the Supreme Court and they said, we want to live in a Jewish village which is established by Israeli American funding, by Jewish American funding, to make settlements within the Green Line. And they said, why? We are equal. I mean, if the Jews can live there, we also want to live there. Very simple. And what do you think the Supreme Court did? They have a right to be there. They have a right to be there because they said, the Jews anywhere can give money whatever they like. But if they give the money to the Jewish government to establish settlements, then the Jewish government cannot make differentiation between Arabs and Israelis. So it forced that village to put in an Arab who really had nothing to do there, but he wanted to make his case. And you know who were the lawyers of that family who wanted to live there? They were Jewish lawyers. Okay.
What is your opinion of Netanyahu agreeing to a ceasefire agreement, which apparently is not written without his inner cabinet, security cabinet, approving it, and the details really have not been released to the Israeli public? And I think there are probably very negative provisions that the public will find out in the future. Do you think that there will be enough uproar to change the Israeli government?
Well, I would say that there is an outrage in Israel about it. But mind you, Israel did not give the Arabs anything. Anything.
That's what he claims.
Who?
Netanyahu.
Yeah. No, but this is true. I mean, there is a ceasefire. Now, at the moment, there is a ceasefire. That's it. And there are going to be negotiations within a month or 2 months from now. So who knows what's going to happen then? But there is a ceasefire. And if the ceasefire continues, maybe it will continue for years. I would say I was against this agreement. I don't like it. But I'm not the decision maker. Netanyahu is. Sorry?
He did extend fishing rights out 6 miles from the ceasefire, and he also is allowing construction materials to pass through the Gaza and Israeli border. So he did make concessions to the Gazans.
As for the fishing thing, this was before. This was allowed before, and because of the blockade, it became 6 miles. Now it turned out into 12 miles. It's true that he made this concession, but it's not a concession that affects Israel in any way. The idea was to give them something that they could, you know, agree to. Because Netanyahu and the cabinet, the majority in the cabinet, were interested in the ceasefire. I think they made a mistake, but that's my opinion.
Why do you think they made a mistake?
Sorry?
Why do you think they made a mistake?
Oh, it's a big mistake. Because this is not going to end. This is, the Hamas has an agenda. Otherwise, they have no right to exist. The agenda is to fight Israel to the resurrection.
Martin Sherman has an article in which he says that this is a diversion, really, away from the Iranian impending problems. Now, my question...
He said that, this war is a diversion?
Yes, this short-term situation is a diversion for the larger issues. But my question pertains to a bigger idea, which you hit on. But you mentioned that the solution is not in the near future. Let's put it that way. But I'm going to ask a very politically incorrect way of asking the question. How much humiliation will it take for the Arabs to want peace? You said that they will both have to want peace. So what will it take for the Arabs to want peace?
Well, there is a theory that if you humiliate an Arab, he will never make peace with you. There's a theory. And Kissinger thought that if you humiliate the Egyptians, they would not make peace with you. Therefore, he forced Israel to withdraw from surrounding the Fourth Army in the time of the Yom Kippur War. I don't think it's a matter of humiliation. There will be peace when the Arabs come to terms with themselves, that the Jewish state cannot be annihilated. Now, Israel is doing anything in its power to show that this is possible, that Israel can be annihilated. Israel is showing weakness every time and again. So when you show the Arabs weakness, they say, oh, maybe we need another round, maybe another round will make. But if they would have known that there is no way to destroy Israel, then they might have made peace, because peace is better for them more than for us.
But what, could you give us that scenario? What is that scenario?
Scenario that there will be peace when they come to terms.
The scenario that Israel will never surrender. The scenario that Israel can.
If Israel would have treated its enemies as the British and the Americans treated the Nazis in the Second World War, then they would have come to understand that this is impossible. Oh.
I have a question about the profile of Netanyahu. He seems like he's all over the place. He's harsh, now he's weak. Are you willing? Please, refuse to answer because it's recorded. Could you profile him? What goes on in this man's head that he winds up making this type of agreement? And part two of the question.
What is he making?
That he does. That he shows such weakness. What is it, and you can argue the cabinet this, the cabinet that, but he is instrumental in these decisions. Part two, where do you really think Israel is going to be 6 months, 1 year, 2 years from now? You're real thinking, not just, if and that, if you're willing to say. If you're not, I understand.
Well, I'm not a prophet. But I think Israel will be there to stay.
Yes, absolutely.
Israel will be there to stay. And as I said, Israel is stronger than anybody thinks. And Israel is a tiny little place with so much ingenuity and so much knowledge. In fact, nothing in the world goes on without an Israeli finger there. You know, whether it's cell phones or whether it's a radio or whether it's a Iron Dome or whether it's missiles or whatever. So I thought you would like me to predict what would happen 50 years from now. 2,000, 2 years from now, I think Israel will be there and will be strong. And if you're talking about Iran, I don't know. With Iran, I'm not sure. I think Israel cannot allow Iran to have a bomb. And Netanyahu did say that, that he would not allow Iran to have a bomb. And this is something that there will be we have to wait and see. But on the whole, Israel is there to stay and to flourish, and I can tell you that we're doing very well.
But the force of Jew hatred in the world, the anti-Semitism all over, and it has an economic effect, it has a psychological effect, we can't disregard this. How does that affect the future and the immediate future? And just,
well, we hear about boycotts against Israel, and there are boycotts against Israel. But when you see the brochure of Israeli trade with the world, it's increasing. It's increasing everywhere. It's increasing with Turkey. Now, I would have thought that the trade with Turkey has gone down because of the animosity between the two countries. No, it's going up. You look at the facts and the figures, and you will find out that it's going up. So there is boycott. It's very annoying, but things are going on.
Professor, my question has to do with Qatar.
Qatar,
the country Qatar, and the fact that the United States has three large military bases in Qatar. And yet, the leaders of Hamas were able to have sanctuary in Qatar, and the Qataris are walking around hand in hand with our President Obama, like they're the best allies of the United States, which I don't feel that President Obama is as pro-American or pro-Israel as you do. But so my question is...
No, I don't think that Obama is pro-Israel.
Okay. I don't think he's pro-American.
Yeah, okay.
So anyhow, my question has to do with Qatar and how, in front of the whole world, can they harbor the leaders of Hamas and also be an ally of the United States at the same time?
They have a lot of money. It's only money. They can buy everything. You know that... you know, Al Jazeera is a very famous television of in Qatar. And it's actually a Hamas television station. And yet, it's still there because it has all this money and nobody wants to get involved with the Qatar. And that's the situation. So. When you have a lot of money, then you have many friends. Yeah. And America is the friends where the money is.
Why can't they get Ishmael Haniyeh? They know everything, or a lot of what happens in Gaza. Why couldn't they have gotten him? He was hiding somewhere like a rat.
Why?
Ishmael Haniyeh. He was in Gaza. Why can't Israel get him?
Well, Israel could have got him. I'm not sure Israel wants to get him. I mean, Ismail Haniyeh, you know, this is one thing I also want to tell you. Maybe, I hope it's not a secret. Israel knows every person in Gaza who has any authority, where he sleeps, where he goes to work, and where he's, what he's doing, and his family as well. You know, to pinpoint someone at a certain second, a certain minute from the air, it means you have very, very good intelligence. No other country in the world has that intelligence.
So how
did
you
thank you.
How did they miss all the information about the tunnels?
Sorry?
How did they miss all the information about the tunnels?
They say, the IDF says, that it knew everything about the tunnels. Because if it did not know about the tunnels, it would have needed 3 months to get to the 32 tunnels that it destroyed. You cannot, you, it's not something that it, it's written anywhere. You don't have signs saying there's a tunnel here. You have to locate those tunnels. If you did not have enough intelligence, you would never have been able to do it in a week. They found it in a week. So they say, I mean, I don't know whether it's, I believe them. There's no reason not to believe them. They say they knew that there were tunnels. But anybody who says he knew that there were tunnels has to explain why he did not destroy them earlier. Why did he let them be there and be a menace and a danger to the people? That's a question that they did not answer. Well, I see that most of the people left, so I'm not sure.
The great people, I have a question.
You didn't answer
it.
I am here.
In your opinion, why did Hamas escalate?
She's got the microphone. Okay. I'm sorry.
How soon do you think the UN Human Rights Commission will be condemning the summary execution by Hamas of the Arabs in Gaza?
Sorry?
How soon do you think the UN Human Rights Commission will be condemning Hamas for its summary execution of Arabs in Gaza without trial? For international war crimes?
This would never happen. This would never happen. The Hamas would not be a subject of investigation by the United Nations, because you know who is there in the United Nations? Is the Libyans and the Syrians and the Iranians.
I want to say something. Somebody made a comment about why is where is it? Because America, like you said, you know, America wants the money. And they just made a deal for something like $22 billion for the dollars, because the thing is, Qatar has a lot of money, a tiny little country. Also, there's an expression, excuse my language.
Is that a question?
Yeah, no. Money talks, you know, money talks and bullshit walks. That's what it is. Money talks. Is that what you said about
it? Yeah, money talks, definitely.
Yeah, I have a question. Why do you and everybody else use the expression settlements? I think that in my opinion, by using the word settlements, it diminishes these communities that I have visited. I'm a friend, a very good friend, of course, knows, of the assistant mayor and the mayor of Kidumi. And they come and they stay with me when they come into town. And I've talked to them about that. Using the word settlements diminishes. They're no different. There's communities. And like I've been to Ariel. You know, why is it that, you know, why do you use the word settlement?
Yeah, you're perfectly right. You're perfectly right. Why we use the word settlements is because it's not under the Israeli jurisdiction. That's why. So to say that a certain city is within the green line and the other city is outside the green line, you have to make the differentiation, and this differentiation is made by settlements and cities. But I agree with you that the word settlement is an Arab narrative or a Western narrative. Exactly. I certainly agree with you. I agree with you. Maybe we should... No, you're right in this too. We should not say Palestinians, we should say Palestinian Arabs. And I always explain that there are Palestinian Arabs and there are Palestinian Jews. For example, I have a very dear friend who was born in Palestine and she's got a birth certificate and a passport. She still holds them saying the state, not the state, but it's Palestine or something. Something like that. You have a birth, so you're a Palestinian. So yeah. So that's why when I say a Palestinian, I try to say Palestinian Arab. That's right. You're right in that. The narrative is very important. It's very important.
One more question, please. In your opinion, why did Hamas start about 3 months ago with the kidnapping
of the three teenagers, with starting with the bombs. I mean, it was relatively quiet for a while. Something must have happened in the world that gave them the drive to start, because they knew if we're going to start shooting Israel, Israel is going to retaliate. Why?
This is what they are there for. This is their raison d'etre. This is what they are for. They are to fight Israel. What do you mean, why? This is what they are. If they don't do that, they have no right to exist. This is the basis of their existence, is to fight Israel every day by terror. That's the whole thing.
Thank you very much. This is all going to be on video.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Ed.